As promised, here is part 2 of the magnetic LoRa antenna. Since our test results were surprisingly good, I decided to evaluate the antenna further and I will provide you with a DIY plan for it. In our last video, which was extra number 4, we introduced a magnetic loop antenna for LoRa operating at 866 MHz. A comparison in a real-life scenario with a quarter wavelength monopole was really encouraging. The received signal strength is more than 10 dB better. The slightly higher antenna gain cannot explain this. We also get a much more stable RSSI, indicated by the lower standard deviation in the measurements. In episode number 14, we also saw that the signal-to-noise ratio can be better with a magnetic antenna. And by the way, in case you're interested in real-life tests and wave propagation for LoRa, I can recommend to digest episodes number 14, 15, 16 and 17. In this episode, we are going to dig a bit deeper to understand the magnetic loop antenna's nature. As promised, a DIY plan is given in this episode. Since the resonance frequency of the magnetic antenna is very sensitive to the mechanical layout, I will give some hints for the resonance frequency tuning. Then I will present the impedance and SWR measurements to give you an idea what you could achieve. Finally, we want to understand why our magnetic loop antenna delivers a more stable RSSI. For this purpose, we will analyze the radiation patterns in three-dimensional space using the program NEC2. For the DIY plan, I was looking for a better construction with a sturdy design and a cleaner look. And I want to have an SMA connector for the antenna instead of an N connector that we had in the first design. My idea is to take two male SMA plugs and an SMA T connector as a solid basis. I'm using a 1 mm copper wire for the ring and the quarter wave transformer. On the left plug, we solder the copper ring to the inner coax conductor and we cover it by a heat shrink. The copper wire, which we soldered to the outer coax conductor, is part of our quarter wave transformer. On the right plug, we solder the copper ring to the outer coax conductor only. The inner coax conductor is not used here. We don't even mount it into the plug. The complete antenna is given in this picture, including the exact measurements. While the diameter of the ring is not very critical, we need to take care about our quarter wave transformer, which transforms the high impedance of the ring to the 50 ohms. We need to adjust both the length and the distance from the ring, which defines the impedance of our waveguide transformer. Once I had a proper adjustment, I fixed the structure with a transparent tape. Then I used the inner part of an electrical screw terminal to adjust exactly the resonance frequency. It's a matter of sliding only millimeters back and forth to find the exact center frequency. I used my Nano Vector Network Analyzer to adjust the resonance frequency, which did a good job here, especially together with the software. Thanks to the software, I can store calibrations and measurements. This helps a lot to work with the Nano VNA, because the user interface from the device itself confuses me completely. I managed to adjust the antenna, but I must admit that I had to fiddle a lot to get this result. Eventually, I managed to adjust the resonance exactly to 866 MHz, which is the frequency that I use for my LoRa tests. The corresponding SWR is like 1.2, as you can see from the diagram. This is what we want. The adjustment of the magnetic loop antenna would be difficult without the help of a vector network analyzer. Today, it is really worth it because you can grab it already for less than 100 bucks. A cheaper method, however, would be the use of a directional coupler, a LoRa transmitter, and an RF measurement device, which I introduced in episodes number 19, 20, 21, and 22. It is also interesting to measure the properties of our antenna in a wider frequency range. Now we look at the range from 100 MHz to 2900 MHz. As we could expect it, on lower frequencies the antenna picks up practically nothing, as we can derive from the very high return loss, which is close to 0 dB. Then we see the first resonance, which we adjusted to 866 MHz. At higher frequencies, we also find a high return loss, except at the second resonance at about 2400 MHz. Okay, the impedance and the return loss measurements can explain that the magnetic antenna doesn't pick up a lot of unwanted signals from other bands. With that, a better signal-to-noise ratio is plausible. However, this doesn't explain the much better RSSI that we get in our measurement scenarios. I think we need to have a closer look on the radiation patterns. The measurement of radiation patterns in three-dimensional space would be a nightmare for hobbyists. However, we can do a numeric simulation to understand the principle. We will use the well-known freeware NEC2 for this purpose. I want to give credit to the developers of CocoNEC, which runs on my Mac. Of course, you will also find Windows versions. Now, just very briefly, this is the geometry input, which you can do in a kind of C language style here. In the case of our magnetic loop antenna, this is particularly complicated because we have to approximate the ring with straight wires. On the bottom, we have the frequency sweep command that computes 10 frequencies between 860 and 870 MHz. let's see just very briefly what else we have. The output console. I don't know what it really means. Seems to be empty. Then we get a listing here where you can get error messages in case your input is wrong. And in the card deck we get the original NEC input format. I think this should be compatible then with all NEC 2 versions. Depending on your input, the output of the program can be a huge data set because it is giving you all the currents on all wires, the radiation patterns in three-dimensional space, and a lot more if you want. I'm showing not even 10% of the complete output data here. The next output window gives us again the old input format. Then it starts to get interesting. We have a summary here showing the elevation and the azimuth diagrams and the impedance of our simulated antenna. Next, we get the geometry of the antenna that speaks for itself. The colors are giving us the currents that flow on the wires. Next, we get scalar plots showing the real and the imaginary part of the impedance. Then we have the impedance in the Smith chart. And then, yeah, we see a potato, which is the total radiation pattern in three-dimensional space. In this representation, we have all horizontal, vertical, left-handed circular and right-handed circular components summed up. However, we can analyze all the components each. Let's see the vertical components only. And then the horizontal components. And then the left and the right-handed circular components. We can find that all components of different polarization have similar gain factors, which are in the order between 3 and 4 dBi. The reason for this effect is a little tricky to understand, and it wasn't my intention originally. The original idea was to only excite the vertical resonance mode on the copper ring, which would only receive vertical polarization. However, with the slightly unsymmetric structure caused by the quarter wavelength transformer, we also excite the orthogonal horizontal resonance mode on the ring. This explains the horizontal and the vertical components with roughly equal antenna gain. Furthermore, we can assume that the unsymmetric structure causes a phase shift between the resonance modes, which explains the circular polarization. The secret why this antenna performs very good in a non-line of sight scenario is now the following. In a non-line-of-sight scenario, we receive a diffuse signal consisting out of all polarizations caused by reflection and diffraction. While our magnetic loop is obviously able to pick up every kind of polarization, the compared monopole antenna cannot. It is receiving the vertical polarization only. We found surprisingly good RSSI results with the magnetic loop antenna compared to an electric monopole. That's why I decided to create a DIY plan for the antenna, even when the resonance tuning is quite a hurdle for hobbyists, because it is relatively sensitive to mechanical changes. And after all, I think I should create a third version again using 2 mm copper wire again, because it is sturdier. Maybe a metal sheet layout would be even better. Just let me know your ideas. The radiation patterns in three-dimensional space, which were analyzed with a NEC2 simulation, are giving us a plausible explanation why the performance of our magnetic loop antenna is a lot better than expected in a non-line-of-sight scenario. Okay, I think this episode was pretty difficult to understand. I guess it is not easy to follow the whole content. But I hope you could take away some know-how from the main messages. At the beginning, I didn't expect where this crazy antenna experiment would bring me. The simple loop antenna that has a circumference of one wavelength provided a lot of secrets to me, which I did not expect. I would be pleased to get some feedback. Further extra videos on interesting topics apart from the usual content will follow from time to time. Now, stay tuned and don't forget to subscribe and support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.